Welcome back, computer people. Today we are starting with implementing our first of hopefully many 2D game graphics renderers. And as I always do, we start with a software renderer. That is fundamentally a very simple thing to do, because after all, what the computer actually, sorry for my scribbling, using a drawing tablet for the first time today. Well, probably I tried it once after buying it. So fundamentally what the computer does when it displays something to a monitor, it has something called a frame buffer internally. And that is just a 2D array of color information, a 2D array of pixels. So it's pretty much, well, a 2D thing. And you can't directly write to it on modern computers, but we just pretend we could. And on older computers, that was actually possible. When you can circumvent your operating system, it is actually still possible on some modern computers. And well, if you look at that, the basic process to draw something like a sprite, well, a sprite internally looks quite similar to your frame buffer. It's also a 2D array of color data. So basically, you can just do a line by line memcopy. And that's your first basic 2D graphics renderer. Line by line, because our X here and our X here are probably quite different. So where a line starts and ends, and after how much data it ends, that's different. So we have to do it line by line to take that into account. So simple, right? I want to, before we get into the code, I want to do a little history lesson about that, how that came to be, and while that seems so simple, how it actually wasn't so simple before. Back in the 70s, when the very first system came to the homes, like there was of course, the Atari. On the one side, there was the Apple II on the other side. And was that both 1977? I don't remember because I'm too young for that. So I quickly check, and yes, both 1977. So both had their about 1 megahertz 8-bit processor, so but there was one big difference between those two systems. This one had a gigantic amount of memory. The first models had 4 kilobytes. The VCS, I think it was 256 bytes. And this, you can probably imagine, is a bit rough for a frame buffer. This one too, so the Apple II had color, but the color information was very limited, and you can see it when you have a look at the games. The color bleeds into neighboring pixels and it looks kind of strange. But the Apple II was, I think, just about the first, or one of the first at least, home systems you could buy which had a straight-on frame buffer you could just draw pixels into. And that was quite interesting for back then, because with a frame buffer you can basically do everything if your CPU is fast enough. The VCS instead had hardware sprites. So that means while the picture is sent to the monitor, you modify some registers and define where those sprites are and how they look. And then the video chip takes that into account while the picture is sent to the monitor. So everything in a VCS game has to be synced very tightly to how the picture is produced. Frame buffer, in comparison to that, much simpler, but of course you need a lot of CPU to fill that quickly with interesting things. And there was another thing, I think it was 1982. There was the Vectrex. That was maybe the first system which had hardware accelerated vector graphics. And the hardware which accelerated that was not some video chip, that was the monitor. Because that, well, it worked like an oscilloscope and just drew lines directly onto your monitor instead of, like your usual CRT goes line by line by line by line and you can't control that. But on the Vectrex, instead, you basically directly control where those lines go. So, vector graphics by monitor support. And as times went on, not much happened here. But a lot happened here, and of course lots and lots of things happened here with the NES, Mega Drive, Super Nintendo, all those arcade machines having more and more sprites and also adding tilemap support. And the one system that, well, the most popular at least, that stayed very stubbornly with just the frame buffer, that was the IBM PC and its compatibles. And the frame buffer also, compared to some other system, was just a linear frame buffer. So you could really very easily address every single pixel without doing any fancy operations. That was not the case on all systems. But those systems were so slow in the 80s that you couldn't completely fill your frame buffer at a decent frame rate. And yeah, one result of that was that something like the NES was much better in terms of 2D games. It had fluid scrolling, and the IBM PC in the 90s, that was, well, very hard to achieve, if at all. And maybe you remember one game that was all about doing just that. That was Commander Keen. And I think that was in 1991, or was it 1990? think 1991. Let's check. No, it was not in 1991 at all. I was so wrong. It was in December 1990. Okay, and the big thing about that was that it had fluid scrolling in all directions, or at least fluid for the time. And when you have a look at the graphics of the first Commander Keen, you can kind of guess how that was achieved, because at any one moment the monitor looks about half empty. So what this game did, it had some trickery in it to only update the portions of the screen which really moved. And by that, this game at the very end of 1990 could almost keep up with an NES game on the PC. But then, just about a year later, we had something like Catacomb 3D, which was this thing, id Software's first textured 3D game. And we also had other things around that time. In 1992, we had Ultima Underworld, and Wolfenstein 3D was at 192, or also 191. It came a little after Catacomb. We had Comanche with its voxel space engine. That was 1992 also. So that was 1991. And then came Doom in 1993. And I think that is very interesting, because we went in 1 to 3 years, depending on how you see it, from not really being able to keep up with an NES to making the game that made the Super NES look totally outdated. And what happened in that time period was that PCs became fast enough to fill the frame rate, to fill the frame buffer every frame for about 30 FPS. Like VGA was typically 70 FPS, and Doom was a 35 FPS game. So, filling the frame buffer, being able to fill the frame buffer fully, and having a bit of overhead on top of that was kind of a breaking point for modern graphics. So, I hope that was a little bit interesting, and we will now jump into 1993 and try to do a similar thing. And around that time, for the very same reason, 2D games on PC also finally started to look good. Before that, it was highly problematic. But luckily, nowadays, our computers are still fast enough to fill the complete frame buffer at a decent frame rate. At least most computers. I'm not entirely sure about all mobile phones with their slow SoCs and their super high resolutions. Yeah, Doom spelled the Doom for the Amiga is in the chat. Yes, that is sadly true. Yeah, what can you do? But it was still important. The Amiga in particular had a frame buffer which was not linear like on the PC, which made it a bit harder. And nobody had fast CPUs, so that didn't quite work out. So we are back to our parrots. And I prepared a bit of code since last time. So it still looks basically the same. This is super slow because we are in debug mode, and debug mode in C and C++ tends to be very slow. Tends to be much slower than something like JavaScript, even for the most part. Yeah, something to keep in mind when your program suddenly becomes unplayable. So I did a little addition to that, and now the parrots can also rotate, which is very realistic. Real parrots also like to rotate. And if you remember from last time wasn't very interesting yet for anyone who doesn't know my software, because I just deferred everything to some pieces of code which were already available. But today, things will be different. Today, we will basically start from scratch. So we'll go back to our update simple first. And I think the number of parrots in there is a bit too much. How about we start with just one who is not rotating? Here is the parrot. And now we try to implement that in software. Can you even see that small parrot on your screen? I hope so. One parrot jumping around. This thing should get me the window on the proper monitor directly. Does that still work? Yes. Okay. So we will completely get rid of our old implementation and start a new one. That's not how that works. That's not how that works either. We are failing already. That's better. So we need the same functions again. Tell me if the font is too small for anyone. This is about the size we figured is okay last time. So everything's still compiling and linking. Yes. So as you may or may not know, the library we are using has different graphics APIs integrated, and it has one API which pretends we had free frame buffer access, and that's the GraphicsOne API. And we will basically just use one function, and that function is called setPixel. So I hope also people who do not use my library will be able to keep up with what's going on here. Because this is not really about showing you how kink works. This is about how 2D graphics work. And I try to keep King in the background as much as possible for that. But I have to use something. And I don't want to use OpenGL because I like my libraries more. But if you don't care about my library at all, just pretend to read pseudocode here. Because we just want to show how all of this works. So, do we have a G1 begin? Not here. Wing. Yes, then we call that too. Boilerplate code. Not very exciting yet. Okay, and draw image has to change a little because it uses a G4 texture. G4 is our 3D shader graphics API, but we don't want to use that here. We just want to have a plain old image. And put that on the screen at that position. So we also have to change something here. Texture in it from image. We don't need that anymore. And we kick out the texture completely so we don't forget anything. Here it is. Bye bye. Parrot visible, font visible. Ah, good to know. Thank you. So, no more texture. It's called image, right? Right. So, another red dot. Ah, that's for the rotating parrots. Okay, is it compiling again? Okay, is it running without crashing? Yes. That's a good first step. So, let's draw the image. That pixel. X, Y. So, let's draw all the pixels. We do a loop. We start with Y because that's a little bit more efficient because of how the memory is laid out. And we start with epsilon. So we better do not call that epsilon. We call it epsilon epsilon. So epsilon epsilon smaller than epsilon. Image, it probably has something like width. Indeed, it has plus plus epsilon epsilon. And another one. But with more x. Ooh, look at that. We catched our first bug. Okay, set pixel, xx, epsilon, epsilon. Let's make a red rectangle first. So, conversion from float to int. Yeah, that's a float, but we want to work in pixels, so let's rounded. Do we have the graphics header, the math header? No. Turns a float. Int, 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 and width and height should be int already. So now it's very int. No more warnings. Do we have a moving red rectangle? Yes. Woo. And we invented the McDonald's logo. Wrong color, but nobody will notice. Yeah, so you probably noticed one problem with that. We need to clear our frame buffer. Let's add a clearing function. Use floats for the colors inside pixels or those. Let's go for floats. So, and we could do a mem set, basically. Let's do a mem set. How does set pixel work? It has something called image, which we are not allowed to access, but we probably don't care. Haha. So, do we know the size of that? Ah, yeah, we are also not supposed to know, but we do know everything. Oh, but for memset, we would have to convert that. Memset takes an int. Our picture should be 4 bytes per pixel, which is an int. So let's try with 0 first. And we need those. That should be more correct in case the texture size is internally different to the size we originally wanted, which doesn't really happen on today's hardware anymore, but let's be correct about it here because it doesn't hurt. So, and memset is where? Is it part of this? Yes, it appears so. So, yeah, of course, we can't actually use memset because it does things char by char. So we can't use an int. This is an int, but it's not interpreted as an int. Still, this should make the screen go black. And that's good enough for today. And today is anyway a bit of a hacky day. We will also skimp a lot of math and just make things work. Today is a make things work day and we won't look back. Next month we will start to make things fast. And one big thing about making things fast is you should understand what you're doing and you have to go really deep in how everything works. But what did I want to do? I wanted to clear. Does it clear? Clearly it clears. Okay. Half of a 2D software renderer already. So how do we get our pixels? Data, internal format, compression. We will ignore that. We will just assume it's RGBA. So we really just need data, width and height. Data is void pointer. Okay. Let's cast it to an int pointer, makes it a bit easier to index it. So now I have to convert it into a float and then it gets converted back into an integer and packed one. Let's start with right, so we have an int. That makes a bit more sense even. Let's make it even nicer. How is the official type called? So, yeah, correct, correct, correct. Why is this red? Cannot, our syntax is off. Image data is void pointer. Our syntax is still off. Standard int. What did we even change now? What are you doing here? That's better. Data. So epsilon epsilon times image. Width, we have one uint per pixel, so that just works, and plus xx. That should be our pixel, right? Maybe. So, we have four colors packed into that. Should be RGBA. So pixel 24 should be our red value. And that's from 0 to 255. So let's do some division and see if we can see a little bit of our Well, that's not a lot. That's not much at all. Oh, that's also not very much. I guess our image disappeared. Let's keep the image around. Did we see a little bit of the parrot in the corner when it started? What is this? Let's stop it from moving. I see a little parrot here. So, what's going wrong when it starts moving? yeah, that's amazing that it didn't crash, but this is not quite right. Because our index was it changed when the parrot moved. We don't really want that. Still there, and can it move now? Ta-da! Let's add more color. So just 16, 8. We should mask those. Okay. We changed the species. That's unfortunate. So, red, green, blue, red, green, blue. Color by color. Green looks pretty green. Blue looks rather dark, which doesn't seem quite right. Is our pixel data the other way around? No. Not quite. Pretty sure none of that is alpha either. But let's have a look at the last one. That doesn't look like the alpha channel at all. That looks like something is really off. Zero is boring. The values don't look too bad. Most of it should be pretty much 255. Yes. This data actually makes a lot of sense because the parrot has a black border. Masking with FF is also correct. This should be our alpha 2. And it looks a bit different. Little Indian, huh? And it's if it's all the way round alpha blue red. Hey, that's almost correct. Almost correct is confusing. Ta-da! Finally. That was more difficult than expected. So. Yeah, we interpret that as a little, yeah. Makes sense, I guess. In a little Endian system, everything is kind of upside down. So this is alpha. Red, green, blue. Blue, green, red. Red, green, blue. And I hope it's still correct. Yes. So, most difficult problem of the evening fixed. So, now there's one additional thing we should do, because when we now draw more parrots, we should see that one thing is not yet working. First, we will probably see that it's already slow. Well, still fast. But the alpha channel is not yet working. And that's a bit unfortunate, because set pixel doesn't even have an alpha value, and it also doesn't have a get pixel. So let's do more hackery and then later add that back to the G1 API, because apparently that's quite important. So to support alpha blending, we have to check alpha, and if we have basically two special cases, if alpha is zero, we do nothing. Else, if it's 255, we do everything. And if it's something in between, things get complicated. So, this is already completely off. So there's actually a bit of alpha in the parrot. That's interesting. We should rework the image file. Very interesting. Okay. Even more important to implement that correctly. Let's make a float of this as well. And alpha of 0.5 means we should take half of the old pixel and half of the new pixel for every color. So and it's more convenient to work with floats here. Semicolon helps. So, let's get the old pixel. So that is our frame buffer. Let's read from it. Our frame buffer is an integer. So then, that was memset. That's why I multiplied with 4. Let's not do that here. That is not quite it yet. This is basically correcting already, and we don't need height here. And I actually so it wouldn't really make a difference, but it's nicer. Makes more sense. We don't want to track any sign bits around. Any warnings? No warnings. Always keep an eye on the warnings when you're writing. See, it's more loose than C++. Well, that's still a C++ file, but this is a pure C file. So we have to keep an eye on that. This is our old pixel. Should be about the same. This is all very old. It's just old. Let's do the floats directly. The alpha value in the frame buffer is actually usually, depending on your blend mode, but for standard blending, it's ignored. Okay. We have our old colors. We have alpha. We have our new colors. So let's set some pixels. This has to be full alpha means we only draw the new pixel. So the new pixel is multiplied with alpha. RF is a new pixel times A plus old red times 1 minus A. And same thing for all of them. Those names don't make any sense. Red float, green float. Ah, this one is off. Blue float. So, blue float, old blue, blue. Green. Green float. Red, green, blue. Anything still missing? Let's see what happens. Whoa. I think it's working. Yeah. So that seems to prove that there's actually a bit of transparency in most of the image. Fancy. So that's alpha blending for you. You just take the proportional part of the new pixel and of the old pixel according to your alpha value. Pretty simple actually, but also pretty expensive. Ah, somebody in the chat also noticed that GB was a bit off, but it sounds like Game Boy. That's also nice. But Game Boy is green, not blue. Anyway, yeah, the problem with blending like that is, yeah, basically this part. We have to read from the frame buffer and then write to it again, so we read something somewhere out of this big memory file, and reading and writing textures or frame buffer, that is one of the more problematic things things in terms of performance because it just takes up a lot of memory bandwidth. And here you can see that we basically double that, because before we just wrote into it without looking, and now we're reading and writing in our potentially big frame buffer. And what's even more troublesome possibly is, well, it might make certain strategies for parallelization more difficult. Like when you do 2D graphics like that, like with some animation film, you have to keep the order in which things are drawn. So one stacks on top of another. But if it wouldn't be for alpha blending, you could basically just collect the images and then only draw the last one, and you would have more opportunities for optimization in probably more ways than I can currently think of. But alpha blending is kind of important nowadays, especially if your ParrotPing file is a bit wonky like ours. So this is already a basic 2D graphics renderer, and this would already be sufficient to do some video games, especially 1993 style video games. But tragically, I added this other code path which tries to rotate our parrots. That is very unfortunate, because that makes things quite a bit more complicated. Because our dumb strategy of basically just copying the data over doesn't work when our parrots are rotated or scaled or transformed in other ways than just translated with the X and Y coordinates. And yeah, what do we do in this case? So the whole aim of this exercise of writing a software rasterizer, and also the reason why I always do it when I explain anything about graphics, I usually start with a software rasterizer, is because you can see everything that's happening. Like that this isn't used anymore. While if you use your graphics card, there are still a lot of things in there you can't see. In particular, how all those triangles are handled and drawn and transformed, and how all of that is parallelized. All of that is invisible to us. We can read a lot of documentation, but that doesn't document everything about modern hardware. We can do a lot of tests and try to get a better understanding of it, but I think the best way of getting a good understanding of that is to re-implement it on your CPU, because on your CPU, well, you can't see everything, but you can see how all of your code works. There's no black box in terms of how pixels are written to the frame buffer in the end. So what we will do here is, when we want to rotate our parrots, let's try and at the same time get closer to how that actually probably works in a GPU. So we will get our paint program back and talk about that a little. So GPUs nowadays, they don't just copy images from one memory region to another. Of course, they can also do that, but mainly, that should be a triangle. It doesn't quite work out. This one looks better. Yeah, they mainly work on triangles, and they can transform them any way they want. And if you did any kind of graphics programming, you probably know there's a vertex shader that works, which is a little function you provide that is called for every corner of your triangle. And typically, what you do in there, you do some kind of transformation for the triangle, and then maybe it looks like that because we rotated it a bit and we scaled it down a bit. And well, one nice. Sorry, I have to get some water after an hour already. Yeah, water is important, but triangles are also important because they are so simple. Because you can do anything you want with those 3 points, move them anywhere, and when you connect them again, it's still a triangle. And well, every thing with x corners stays a thing with x corners after that, but rectangles like that, they could take on rather different forms like this, which might be a bit more difficult to render. With a triangle, you probably don't care at all because the properties of a triangle, well, there just aren't that many. You might have a right angle somewhere at one corner, but that's about it, right? But with a rectangle, it might. Well, that's not a rectangle anymore, for one. If it started as one, it can be anything with 4 corners in the end. And if you're talking about 3D, in the end, it maybe isn't even planar anymore and just doesn't fit into one plane. And what do we do then? Well, luckily, we are only doing 2D graphics here, so we don't care that much about it. But we will see in a moment that it actually adds some complexity to do rectangles instead of triangles. But we want to draw our parrots, and our parrots are rectangular. So we stay with that and do things a little bit different than GPUs nowadays do. Well, we are basically a Sega Saturn. That one also, did everything with rectangles or with 4 corner things. What's the English word for that? Anyway, you probably know it. In German, we literally call it a 4 corner. Sometimes German is really easy. And how do we get something with some weird form to our screen. The traditional method are so-called scanline algorithms. So what you do is, you have a triangle again, and this triangle consists of three line segments, from here to here, from here to here, and from here to here. And what a scanline algorithm does is it goes line by line. Whoa, those are some wonky lines. So one bad thing nowadays is when you look for scan lines via some search machine, you have to click through a whole lot of pages about emulators who try to emulate CRT scan lines until you find the first page about scan line rasterization. But anyway, some people still remember what that was. And when you go on, at some point, you are in between min epsilon and max epsilon of your triangle. That's pretty easy to figure out. You just take your three epsilons and take the minimum and the maximum. So, and when our scan line tells us we are in there, we do the same tests with our x. So, and then for every line, we figure out which two line segments are relevant. In this case here, it's this one and this one. So we can do a little shortcut at the start, because with a triangle has this interesting property that there's always one line which goes from the very top to the very bottom. You can try that out. It's true for every single triangle. There's at least one line, maybe two, when it has a flat bottom, but at least one line which goes from the very top to the very bottom. So this line segment is always relevant, and then it's one of the other, and we can figure out which one by comparing our line with the epsilon of that middle corner in terms of epsilon. So now we know which line segments they are, and yeah, you probably remember a little bit of math from school. That was maybe fourth grade or something, so already a little bit more complicated. But given two points on a line, you can figure out every point of the line in between. And this way, we can find this point and this point. And this is exactly what we do for the scan line. And then we just draw some nice pixels in between here. And so we go on. We figure out the first and the last. And we fill this in. And when we're here, we will have a finished triangle. So, tragically, for a rectangle, this is a bit more complicated. Because we have four line segments. And let's do this a little bit more like this. And we don't have this one line segment which goes all the way to the bottom. So we have a bit more work to do to find this line segment and this line segment for the scan lines on top. But when we have our line segments, we can do exactly the same thing. So it's just a bit more code to basically sort our points. And there will always be a top point and the bottom point. So we will always start with the two lines which are connected to the top point. And then we have to find the second point. And then we have a little segment where we have, well, this is our relevant one. Little segment like this here, actually, where we have this line and this line. And then we are below this other one, which is not quite as high as this one. And then we have these two line segments. So you can probably imagine the code for that is not complicated, but a little bit annoying. But it works too. And something like this is pretty much the classical way of rasterizing your geometry. Scanline algorithms. But we won't do that today. But if you want to do that, I have some pretty old links for you. Let's see if I can quickly find them. I think I can. Look at this. This was back when I was 7. No, that's not the actual code. 4 years ago. Yeah. That was for a university lecture. And of course, we also started with a software renderer. And that was, though, actually a software renderer for 3D graphics. So we did that with triangles, of course. And here you can see pretty much what I just told you. Look at that, the long edge. Then it goes through here. And then it draws between the first two edges and then between the second two edges and draws spans between edges. This figures out those positions and then draws between them. And in the end, we just end up with our set pixel calls again and draw a red triangle. And when we draw lots of them, we can make fancy 3D graphics. And I think solution 4, then added textures. Did it do that? Yeah, look at that. UV coordinates. Oh, read pixel from image. Does that look familiar? Didn't do alpha blending, I guess. So, if you want to render some triangles the really classical way, you can have a look at that. And let's keep some text file going with all the links I'm mentioning. Which I can then add later to somewhere where you can see it. So that's that. So, but we will do something which is a little bit different. And, there's the page. We will do some math in the worst possible way by doing a little bit of copy and paste programming from one of the most clever persons in the video game industry, Mr. Giesen. So, almost 10 years ago, don't tell him or he will feel old, he wrote a blog post which pretty much explains how rasterization works nowadays. And there's some math involved with determinants. But as it turns out, it is a really small amount of code. And that's nice, right? So, what we will do today is we will actually do some very evil copy and paste programming based on this, and we will just get it to work. But we can't let it stay like that. And next month, when we start making things fast, we won't get around it, and we will have to understand the math behind this also. But today, we will cheat, because it's 1.5 hours in already, and I don't even understand the math myself yet. So, what can I do? Start reading, of course, but not now, when we're done here. So, let's draw some rectangles which can be rotated. Let's steal all the code and nobody tell him about it. So, of course, again, somebody is using triangles and we want to do rectangles. So, what he's doing here, he is taking some kind of determinant based on 3 points, and what he is putting in here is always 2 corners of the triangle and some point for which he wants to know whether it's part of the triangle or not. You can see a similar loop like we did earlier, which goes for epsilon and x. And at the start of it, it calculates the min and max, x and epsilon. So we have our bounding box to save on some computation time. And then he does this fancy determinant business and gets some values back. And when they are larger or equal to 0, then we are inside of the triangle. Isn't that nice? And what we are getting back here are actually so-called barycentrics. And barycentrics, do I still have something open for that? No, I don't. One moment. Astronomy? No. That's all not nice. Googling some more. I think I saw something nicer earlier. Oh, that's tragic. The thing I saw is German. And here the English one doesn't have the nice image I wanted to show. Let's skip the text and go for images. A barycentric coordinate. It basically tells you how close you are to the different corners. And they are used for texture coordinates. So, if you know GPU programming again, inside of your triangle in your pixel shader, you get those nicely interpolated coordinates based on what you put out in the vertex shader, and those are interpolated based on the barycentric coordinates of the triangle. So that's another math thing we will hack our way around today, which we have to get deeper into when we want to make this fast. But those values will tell us where we can read data in the texture. So now let's make this compile, unless anybody has any questions. No, it's all still easy. We skip over all the math and somebody will be mad about it. But we won't be able to skip it anyway in the end. So, making a compile, click mini. Screen height, screen width. Ah, this is clipping against the screen bounds. Makes sense. Yeah. Internal width and height. So min 3, max 3. Yeah, turn mini, very mini, very maxi. So this should almost compile. Render pixel. Look at that. We will care about the correct color value later. First, let's just get anything on the screen. So, triangle. Triangle is not good enough. We want more. So, can we easily extend this to a quad? Well, I guess we need more of everything. No, 3, 0, 1. I'm already confused. 0.1. Min and max. Okay, confusion almost resolved. So. Four. A, B, C, D. Also 4. Let's get the drawing tablet out of the way. That helps. Minform x4 that compiles. So, and so this can we also just extend this? Let's see. You know, don't tell your parents about my methods of making things work. So let's see. Let's go from 0 to 1, 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 0. Sounds rectified. We have the 0.4. Let's make this a little less C++ and a little more C. So we can at one point actually compile this as C instead of C++. That's also our target. Because the API is C also, and it compiles a bit faster. But also not that important today. So that should compile, maybe. Look at that, it compiles, but it still uses the old draw image function. So let's create a new one. Oh, and that's quad. Quad, that's the word I was searching for. Now it came back. So we have X and Y, draw quad. We have the silly point structs. Well, we can do it. We can do it. Now we render random values. So this takes int, this loads. So let's go roundabout this. And we let's define what our coordinates are for our we don't rotate it quite yet, so we start with something like this, and we go V0. V1, V2, V3. Okay, let's put this to the side for now. So V1 dot X is x plus image width. Is it actually complaining about anything here? Syntax error. Here. Guess this is better. So v1 is to the right. Like this, then we go down and then we go left again and soon things will get exciting because we will see whether our totally wild hackery here is actually doing anything reasonable. Let's have a look at those. Ah, king crown returns a float. So we make that very int and it should stop complaining. Yes, that seems okay. Look at that. That's not half bad, is it? Aha. We have some actual rectangles with the silliest math you have ever seen. But you know, that's kind of how it works when you get your barycentrics like that. Yeah. Now let's keep our red rectangles for a moment and try to actually make them rotate. So making them rotate means we go the easy way and we just use some transformation matrices which are already inside of kink and which are still only really in the core API, which is the C++ API. But yeah, that will make it easier for now. But eventually, we will also have to drill into that and see how to simplify that. But there's also eventually the question of do we or do we not want to support all transformation you can do via a 3x3 matrix? Because in theory, we could do that. It would be a bit slower, of course. And I'm not yet sure it's worth it. So let's keep some transformation matrix around. Transform. Let's have a quick look if the what the rotation update does when we just use it right now. G4, G4. That's just boilerplate. I was looking for that because we didn't add that to the other one yet. Yeah, and basically the only difference is this calls the rotation function. So it should just work still, but without rotating things. Let's see. Yes, looks just like before. So now let's see if we can make it rotate. So to rotate something, you need to know around what you are rotating. And to do this with matrices, you first do a translation. To that center by using negative of that. Then you multiply with a rotation and around set. This is 2D, of course, so there's not really any Z, but this will still return the correct thing for, because when you rotate in 2D, you're basically always rotating about around the Z axis, even though it doesn't really exist. And then you go back the old position. So transform. Ooh. Transform is this. Does this compile? Okay. Now, annoyingly, we have to put this data into another vector structure. But let's keep the floats while doing this transformation. Let's keep it a bit floaty for a moment longer. So I think they are called, we use VEC3, we use homogeneous coordinates. Another fancy thing. Let me just put the last one to 1. Another piece of math which we are just skipping over today. But what can you do? We are already 2 hours in. Of course, I'm using that as an excuse. I haven't even prepared explaining all the math here. But as you can see, and that is, I think, quite interesting, we are stumbling into more and more math here for the simple thing of just drawing some transformed quads or even just rectangles. Interesting, right? So let's transform them. Working with matrices is rather easy when you know how. And now we just put those in here. I think that's actually, yeah. Width and height should now instead go in here because we apply the transform to every point. So in theory, so far this would work for any transform. We start in the top left. We move to right. We move down and we move back to the left. So there they are, and then down here it's just those values. Is that it? What do you think? Maybe, maybe not. Let's rotate some. I think that looks entirely correct. Wowie. We're getting close to our target for today. So now, of course, we don't want just some rotating quads. We want rotating parrots. So, and for that, for each pixel, we need to know where we are inside of the rectangle, and our W values here tell us that, because they are the barycentrics. But what we get back here is not yet in the range from 0 to 1. But when we go just a little bit into what's happening here, and now we simplify a bit more than we should, well, again, but this time we are actually kicking out our ability to do any transforms by doing another little silly hack to get our texture coordinates. So, going from V0 to V1 and V2 to V3, when you look at our rectangle, it's this one and this one. So we're going here and we're going here. And with the barycentrics, we get the maximum value when we're at the end. And the in-between value when we're, well, not at the end. And because we are calculating both of those, well, distances, basically, which is kind of silly, but because we do that, we can actually get away with a silly little hack. Look at this. Do you think this will work? Maybe now? Let's put the U in here. That looks good, right? That looks almost like our texture coordinates. Maybe it's upside down. But, well, in graphics programming, things always end up upside down. You know, in the ancient times, people called that gouraud shading. Now, we just need to use these UV coordinates and get the data from our image. So we basically just have to copy in this again. Let's rework this a little bit. Dum-dum-dum-dum. We provide the image. Do we have the image? Then we have to. We do have the image because it's here. We just have to provide it here. And then what else do we want to provide? We want to tell it where to draw. Frame X. And what pixel to pick? Oh, well, basically, you and we. So, da-dum, da-dum, da-dum. So, we don't have to do a loop anymore. We want the coordinates inside of our image, and that is u times image width, and let's just round it. Can we get pixel out of our image now? When it's 1 max. Actually, we can. When this is 1, this is width, then that's not good. And when this is 0, and that's kind of okay. So let's do this for now and think a little more about it later. Now this goes from 0 to 1. With 0, it's 0 anyway, and that's good. That's, well, not good, but okay. And we have, and the second pixel is 1 off. Well, it will look kind of okay. So that's image X. And data is image data. This is gone. Image data. We use image X. Oh, do we? No. No image X. So, and this way we have our pixel. And we want to put that at frame X and frame epsilon. So, and wow, this This was not correct at all. Neither was this. But this is better. See? Software never really works. Just randomly kind of works. So, that's just an internal thing. So, and we want to use that here. Draw pixel. Image is not here yet. That's p dot x, p dot epsilon, uv. So just have to put the image in. So can this possibly work? Ta-da. Rotating parrots. Yeah, I guess that's good enough for today. Let's run it in release mode and do a really quick and silly performance test. It's not fast yet. As you can probably tell, but it's working. And it isn't even looking that bad. Well, with that speed, you can at least have a nice look at the rotations. So, and I guess this will be it for today. We got things to work. But it's still really wonky. We don't even understand half of it yet. So next time, we will actually go down into the math. And I hope you wish me all luck for that, because I have to brush up my math myself for that. And hopefully I can figure out how to explain it nicely and find a nice compromise for how deep to go with that. And so we will try this next month and then of course apply that and see how we can maybe simplify some things and verify that things are correct the way we do them. Like with this indexing here, we will add bilinear filtering to make it nice when the parrots grow big and kind of nice when they grow small. And maybe we'll even add mip mapping. And then we will have something that's still slow, but works correctly and has all the features. And then we will start making it fast. And making it fast will mainly mean making everything parallel. So we will use a bunch of threads and we will use a whole bunch of SIMD instructions. And then we will be able to do a lot of pixel plotting in parallel. So, is anybody still around today and has any questions? What was that name of the shading? Ah, that was Gouraud shading. That's, I think, a French word. I know how to write it, but I'm not entirely sure how to pronounce it. So I'll show you the Wikipedia article. This one. A grow shaded sphere. Yeah. Basically, this difference was a thing back then. Game started with flat shading, which just used the same color across the whole polygon. And grow shading, it basically was a totally silly thing, but they just interpolated the colors based on the colors which were calculated on the corners of the quad or the triangle. And then it looked kind of better depending of how your model looks, or it still looked kind of silly like here. Because when you have a small light like that, your calculations for the light, they are only applied at those triangle corners, and then the colors are just interpolated. And that doesn't look nice. And what we do today instead is instead of interpolating the colors, we interpolate those UV values you have seen, and then do the lighting calculations for every pixel. And then this would look much nicer. It would look basically like this, but with not so nice edges. Yeah. Any more questions? Yeah, I think that's it for today then. And I hope I will see you all, well, all three of you, or however many are left, next month to figure out all those homogeneous coordinates, to figure out the barycentrics and the determinants. And make sure what we are doing actually makes sense instead of what we did today, which was just making it work as quickly as possible with any means possible. Okay, then thank you for joining and see you next time.